Ever since I started to take music seriously, one-hit wonders have always been one of the most interesting aspects to me. And this is what started it. When I looked for more, however, I found the New Radicals had only ever released one album. Maybe you've been brainwashed too. What happened to this group after such a promising start?
"90 miles outside Chicago, can't stop driving, I don't know why."
As it turns out, lead singer Greg Alexander brought the project off as he didn't like it, and you could tell just by looking at his live shows or his other music videos. Always with that eye-concealing bucket hat, a telling sign of someone who shies away or rejects the camera, Alexander chose to focus on the background work, writing and producing, and he's had some great success. Murder on the Dance Floor by Sophie Ellis-Bextor in 2001, which he co-wrote and co-produced, and The Game of Love by Santana, featuring Michelle Branch, in 2002, which he again co-wrote and co-produced, but under the pseudonym Alexander. These are two of the most noteworthy of his, and both fantastic songs from a writing and compositional standpoint. But that's just one-hit wonder. So let's delve a little deeper and look into more reasons why one-hit wonders just come and go. A one-hit wonder is a band or artist primarily known for only one hit song, a song that completely overshadows the rest of their career. To me, a hit is a song that gets from the top 20 on the Hot 100 or the UK singles chart. Some great examples are My Sharona reached number 6 in the UK singles charts, and the follow-up reached 66, and that was it for the Knack. Play That Funky Music peaked at number 7, and Wild Cherry never reached the charts again. The reason why One Hit Wonders interest me so much is because it captures that one moment of fame, a flash in the pan, and the slow and sometimes instant death of an artist in the limelight. While You Get What You Give is already a great example of an artist who turns down the opportunity to follow their real goal, this is another. Thomas Dolby's She Blinded Me With Science, the ultimate weird new wave song of the early 80s. Dolby, real name Thomas Robertson, was one of the people that experimented with brand new synth tech in the late 70s and the early 80s, when they were extremely expensive. So to put it in other words, he was a massive nerd. And this song perfectly reflects everything about his character as he portrays a mad scientist. The song's video itself took off on MTV, helping the song to its peak. It features Magnus Pike, a well-renowned scientist who appeared in broadcast as an educational figure as he tries to give Thomas Dolby his diagnosis in the home for deranged scientists. The video was directed by Dolby too. A perfectly quirky and synthy outfilled song. As Dolby became more proficient with synthesizers, he found out he enjoyed the background much more, releasing albums out of personal interest. He became a support act in demand as Stevie Wonder and Herbie Hancock would acquire him to perform in the 1985 Grammy Awards ceremony in an event called the Synthesizer Showdown, and Dusty Springfield would inquire about him. He even got on stage with David Bowie at Live Aid 85 as a keyboardist. As time has gone on, he has wrote film scores and became the musical director for TED Conference. He also created the most iconic ringtone of the 2000s. A novelty song, to me, is a song that portrays some form of humour or some form of gimmick. And more often than not, the older they are, the worse they are. One of the biggest songs of all time, the Macarena, was originally made by Spanish duo Los Del Rio, but when Bayside Boys remixed the song, they simply placed a beat onto it, along with English excerpts, and just took the world by storm. It lingered in the Hot 100s for 60 weeks, just showing how powerful gimmick songs can be. But I don't think we've seen a more influential gimmick song than... A song that took 10 minutes and 2 takes peaked at number 1 in the US, UK and several other countries. Inspired by his generation's martial arts films, Douglas wanted to create an ode to them and ended up kickstarting a second martial arts craze. Such an infectious and upbeat song. However, he did obtain 2 more top 40 hits in the UK with Run Back and surprisingly Dance to Kung Fu, which more or less was a rehash of Kung Fu Fighting. Douglas hasn't done much since the disco scene dissipated, but Kung Fu Fighting has had a profound influence on movies. Films with a romantic plot often have a compilation or a montage of events paired with a song. This is one of, if not the most famous film song of all time, as Titanic broke box office records and won 11 Oscars. My Heart Will Go On was also nominated for several awards, winning an Academy Award, a Grammy Award, and a Golden Globe. But this is from an artist that has had long-standing success. This is only a classic example. While not being a box office smash, Bally Girl was heralded for its extremely strong soundtrack. Director Martha Coolidge handpicked a roster of new wave bands to feature on her movie, and most importantly to me, it features this. I Melt With You gained a significant amount of fame off the back of Valley Girl. Coolidge liked the song so much, she played it twice. While the meaning of the song is quite dark, it comes off as a jovial love song that beams with early 80s charm, and prompted Modern English to move to New York to continue their career. However, they would see the charts only once more in the 80s with Hands Across the Sea, peaking at 91 in the Hot 100, and the band broke off in 1987. They would form again in 1989 and gain a second top 100 hit, a re-recording of I Melt With You that peaked at 2 spots higher than the original. Since then, the band have broken up, reformed and stayed together since 1995. But how did they not catch on? Well, they were screwed by the higher-ups. Epic Records struggled with clearance problems for all the songs used in the film, so the soundtrack album was canned. Eventually the job fell to Rhino Records, who did get the job done, but it was far too late, as the release came in 1994. In recent times, Somebody That I Used to Know by Gotye featuring Kimbra was one of the most influential pop songs of the early 2010s, and peaked at number one in 23 different countries. It was massive, and to this day, it has accrued 1.6 billion views over its near 10-year stay on YouTube. Truly one of the biggest one hits of all time, but what happened to Gotye? Before all this, Gotye had released two solo albums, Bored Face in 2003 and Like Drawing Blood in 2006, along with his band The Basics, who he's been performing with since 2002. He wanted a break, and after collaborating with Illuminar on Fractured Heart, an interactive art piece, he went on hiatus. He still performs with The Basics, and has since performed a concert dedicated to electronic music pioneer Jean-Jacques Perry after his death in 2016. One-hit wonders are one of the most important features of the music industry. It shows just what that fleeting moment of being on top of the world can do to people, and how they deal with the newfound fame. They truly are one of the most intriguing features of the world of music.